خير الهدي هدي محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم وشر الأمور محدثاتها وكل محدثة بدعة وكل بدعة ضلالة وكل ضلالة في النار. Alhamdulillah, we praise Allah and we seek His assistance and we seek His forgiveness. And we seek refuge in Allah from the evil within ourselves and from our bad deeds. Whoever Allah guides, there is none that can lead him astray. And whoever is led astray, then there is no guide for him. I bear witness that no God is worshipped in truth other than Allah. He is alone and has no partners. And I bear witness that Muhammad is His slave and His messenger. O you who believe, fear Allah and say that which is correct, in order that He may accept from you your deeds and forgive you of your sins. And whoever obeys Allah and His Messenger has achieved the greatest achievement. Amma ba'du. Certainly the most truthful speech is the Book of Allah, and the finest guidance is the guidance of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And the most evil of affairs are newly invented matters in this deen, and every newly invented matter in this deen is a bid'ah, and every bid'ah is a straying, and every straying is in the hellfire. Continuing with the Aqidah of Abu al-Hassan al-Ash'ari rahimahullah, last week we were with the statement, and Allah will definitely resurrect those who are in the graves. And this week, inshallah ta'ala, we would be finishing off that statement and the statement of the Shaykh, وَأَنَّ اللَّهَ اسْتَوَى عَلَى عَرْشِهِ كَمَا قَالَ الرحمن على الأرش استوى وأن له سبحانه وجها بلا كيف كما قال ويبقى وجه ربك ذو الجلال والإكرام وأن له سبحانه يدين بلا كيف كما قال سبحان خلقت بيدي وكما قال بل يداه مبسوطتان وأن له عينا بلا كيف كما قال سبحانه تجري بأعيننا وأن من زعم أن الله أن اسم الله غيره كان ضالا. The Shaykh Abu Hassan al-Ash'ari حفظه الله ورحمه, he says, and Allah has rose high above His throne, and He has said, as He has said, Ar-Rahman has rose high above His throne. Surah Al-Taha, verse number 5. And He, glorified is He, has a face without describing high, without describing how, as He has said, and the face of your Lord will remain forever, dhul jalali wal ikram, full of majesty, bounty and honor. Surah Al-Rahman, verse number 27. And He, glorified is He, has two hands without describing how, as He, the glorified, has said, that which I have created with my two hands, Surah Al-Sa'd, verse number 75. And He has said, rather His two hands are wide open, Surah Al-Ma'idah, verse number 64. And He has an eye without describing how, as He, the glorified, has said, she floats under our eyes, Surah Al-Qamar, verse number 14. And whoever thinks that Allah's names are describing other than Him, then he is astray. Abu al-Hassan al-Ash'ari rahimahullah, as we were ending off last week, said, and Allah would definitely resurrect those who are in the graves. And last week we were mentioning the importance of the hour coming, and that there's no doubt about it, and that Allah would resurrect those who are in the graves. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has mentioned in too many verses in His Quran the fact that we will be resurrected from our graves or brought back to life after we have died, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in Surah Al-Baqarah, verse number 28, كَيْفَ تَكْفُرُونَ بِاللَّهِ وَكُنْتُمْ أَمْوَاتًا فَأَحْيَاكُمْ ثُمَّ يُمِيتُكُمْ ثُمَّ يُحْيِيكُمْ ثُمَّ إِلَيْهِ تُرْجَعُونَ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in this verse is showing the importance or that which we benefit from understanding that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would resurrect us after our deaths. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, how can you disbelieve in Allah and you were dead? Meaning you had no life before this life that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given you. And then Allah gave you life. And then He will take your life. And then He will give you life again. And then to Him you will return. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala here is humbling His creation and calling them to the worship of Allah tabarak wa ta'ala alone by saying, how could you disbelieve in Allah? How could you not establish the tawheed of Allah in your life? How could you not bear witness that Allah is the only one that has the right to be worshipped when you used to be dead? Meaning you weren't even living yesterday. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He reminds us of this oftentimes, as He tells us in the beginning of Surah Al-Insan, هَلْ أَتَى عَلَى الْإِنسَانِ حِينٌ مِّنَ الدَّهْرِ لَمْ يَكُنْ شَيْئًا مَذْكُورًا. Has there come about a time when humanity wasn't even something thought about? And here Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala was referring to even Adam before the creation of Adam. And if we can think back all the way to Adam alayhi salam, and to think back before even Adam was created, that there was a time when no one was created. There were no human beings. And we can definitely remember, if we think back 50 years or 100 years, that we weren't even created. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave us our lives, and we are living them right now, alhamdulillah. And Allah is going to take our lives. And no one doubts the fact that Allah is going to take your life, their lives. No one thinks He's going to live forever. But then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reminds us of that which the Shaykh is mentioning from our aqeedah, and that is that Allah will definitely resurrect those who are in the graves. Allah would bring back to life those who are in the graves, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, and then we will give you life again. And then to Him, you will return. Then to Allah, you will return to be judged for what you did with your life in this world. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is establishing this fact that we're going to be raised up again in order to make us fear Him while we're living right now, so that when He raises us back to life after our death, that we would be in a state that is pleasing to our Lord subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us in Surah Al-Waqi'ah, making it clear for those people who think that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala doesn't have the power to bring the people back to life after they have died. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us in verse number 47-50 in Surah Al-Waqi'ah, وَكَانُوا يَقُولُونَ أَإِذَا مِتْنَا وَكُنَّا تُرَابًا وَعِظَامًا أَإِنَّا لَمَبْعُثُونَ أَوَآبَاؤُنَا الْأَوَّلُونَ قُلْ إِنَّ الْأَوَّلِينَ وَالْآخِرِينَ لَمَجْمُعُونَ إِلَى مِيقَاتٍ مَعْلُومٍ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, and they used to say, and this is the statement of the kuffar in general, the disbelievers, and they say, are you telling us when we die and we become dirt and bones that we're going to be raised back to life again? Or are you telling us that our forefathers who passed before us, they're going to be brought back to life also? Not just us, but them too? Allah commands us to say, indeed, those from before all the way to the end, to Yawm al-Qiyamah, they will all be brought back together on an appointed day. That's well known. Here Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is making it clear that everyone is going to be resurrected and brought back to life and held accountable for what he did in this world. And that no one's going to miss this fact of being raised back to life. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is making clear here in Surah Al-Waqi'ah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in Surah Al-Mujadila, verse number 6, reminds us with the statement, يَوْمَ يَبْعَثُهُمُ اللَّهُ جَمِيعًا فَيُنَبِّئُهُمْ بِمَا عَمِلُوا أَحْصَاهُ اللَّهُ وَنَسُوهُ وَاللَّهُ عَلَى كُلِّ شَيْءٍ شَهِيدٍ. A day when Allah would resurrect all of them, a day when Allah would bring all of them back to life. From the time of Adam alayhi salam to the last person who dies before Yawmul Qiyamah. Allah would resurrect all of them on that day. And then He would inform them of what they did. And here Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is showing us that this day that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is going to resurrect us back to life, that this day is all about being informed of what you did while you were living. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has allowed things to transpire as they have, that yesterday we weren't here, we weren't even thought about. Today Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is blessing us with our lives. Tomorrow we'll be dead, and then after that Allah would bring us back to life. Bringing us back to life to remind us of what we did when we had this life. Reminding us that He has created us for the purpose that He reminds us of in Surah Al-Dhariyat, وَمَا خَلَقْتُ الْجِنَّ وَالْإِنسَ إِلَّا لِيَعْبُدُونَ. And I have not created the jinn nor the mankind to worship me. On that day that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala brings us back to life, He's going to remind us of what we did, of how good we fulfilled our purpose in life of worshiping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Allah has taken all of these things into account that we've done, and they have forgotten. We, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, sent His messengers and His prophets to humanity to give us the message. Ya qawmi a'budu Allah, ma lakum min ilahin ghayru. O my people, worship Allah. No one has the right to be worshipped other than Him. And we knew that. And we knew that our purpose in life was to establish this tawheed of worshipping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone. And then we forgot about it. And we lived our lives the way we wanted to live them. And when we are brought back to life, Allah is going to remind us. As Allah has taken everything into account. Even though the unmindful forget, and they don't remember their purpose in life, or they don't fulfill their purpose in life, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala isn't missing anything. Allah takes everything into account and they forget it. And Allah is shaheed over all things. And Allah is a witness over all things. Here Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is reminding us, as He's reminding us in all of these verses. Not just to remind us that we're going to be raised back to life again. As if, you know, it's just like being born. The lady's pregnant. Couple of months, she drops her load, a new baby comes, mashallah, alhamdulillah, you have the aqiqah, and the baby is off with their life. It's not going to be just that easy when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala brings us back to life. Okay, we're brought back to life again, just like a new baby, just live our lives. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is letting us know that when He brings us back to life again, it's going to be for real. And it's going to be for the ever living, everlasting life that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has in store for humanity. And that either it's going to be in Jannah or it's going to be in the hellfire, depending upon did we worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala or not. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala isn't just calling us to believe in the fact that we're going to be resurrected, but that this is to remind us of our purpose in life, so that we can be prepared when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala raises us back to life again. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us in Surah Al-Taghabun, verse number 7, زَعَمَ الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا أَلَّنْ يُبْعَثُوا قُلْ بَلَى وَرَبِّي لَتُبْعَثُنَّ ثُمَّ لَتُنَبَّأُنَّ بِمَا عَمِلْتُمْ وَذَلِكَ عَلَى اللَّهِ يَسِيرٌ. Those disbelievers, they allege or they claim that they will never be brought back to life again. They claim that they will never be resurrected. Say to them, surely indeed your Lord is going to resurrect you. And then He's going to inform you of what you did, and that's easy for Allah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala here is showing us, for anyone who has any doubt left in his mind that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala couldn't bring anyone back to life after their death, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is reminding us that this is very easy for Allah to do. And that the only people who think that Allah won't do this are the disbelievers. As the disbelievers claim that they won't be brought back to life, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commands us, I command you to tell them, surely your Lord is going to resurrect you and inform you of what you did. This belief that the Shaykh rahimahullah Abu al-Hassan al-Ash'ari is trying to implant in the minds and the hearts of the believers, and Allah will definitely resurrect those who are in the graves, this aqeedah and this belief is a reminder to us to fulfill our duties to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and to stop half-stepping with this deen, and to do as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has commanded us when He says, Ya ayyuha alladhina amanu udkhulu fis-silmi kaffa. O you who believe, I command you to enter into Islam wholeheartedly, all the way, and not to be half-stepping. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, alhamdulillah, as we brag all the time that Allah has completed this deen, when we're giving da'wah to the kuffar, that we have a deen that is complete. A favor from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to humanity, as Allah tells us, الْيَوْمَ أَكْمَلْتُ لَكُمْ دِينَكُمْ وَأَتْمَمْتُ عَلَيْكُمْ نِعْمَةِ وَرَضِيتُ لَكُمُ الْإِسْلَامَ دِينًا. This day I perfected for you your deen, your way of life, your religion, and completed my favor to you, and I've chosen for you Islam as a way of life. This complete deen that covers every aspect of our lives, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is going to hold us accountable for practicing it. If we know that Islam enters into our belief, we know that Allah is going to hold us accountable for what we believe in. We know that Islam enters into our marriages. So we know that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is going to hold us accountable for our marriages. We know that Islam enters into how we treat our parents and the rest of our family members, our relatives. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is going to hold us accountable for how we deal with them. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has made a part of this deen the way we dress. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is going to hold us accountable for it. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has made a part of this deen cleaning ourselves. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is going to hold us accountable for each and every aspect of our lives that He has commanded us to worship Him in by each of these aspects. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala isn't going to miss any of this. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is shaheed over all things that we do. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is reminding us that He's going to bring us back to life so that we will know that we're going to be held accountable for what we are doing right now, what we're saying, what we're doing, and what we're believing. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He tells us in Surah Al-Hud, وَلَئِن قُلْتَ إِنَّكُم مَبْعُثُونَ مِن بَعْدِ الْمَوْتِ لَيَقُولُنَّ الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا إِنَّ هَذَا إِلَّا سِحْرٌ مُبِينٌ إِنَّ هَذَا إِلَّا سِحْرٌ مُبِينٌ. This is Surah Al-Hud, verse number 7, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, and if you would say, indeed you are going to be resurrected, indeed you are going to be brought back to life after you die, indeed those people who disbelieve, they will say, this is only but clear magic. I just wanted to bring this verse, as it's funny that yesterday, many of us, we didn't believe that there was any life after this death. And that we used to argue and debate with the people who would tell us that we're going to be brought back to life. And I was one of those people who thought that when you die, that's it. You live for this dunya, because what you're going to get is what you're going to get, because when you die, it's all over. Until Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala guided me to the truth of this deen, and I like to remind myself that we're going to be brought back to life again. And that no one should ever believe, like the disbelievers believe, that it's over with. Do whatever you want to now, because when you die, it's all over. It's not all over when you die, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is telling us here and making it very clear, so that we don't have to think like the disbelievers, that if there is a resurrection, then there's a mental resurrection. You were dead, you didn't have the proper understanding. Then you were brought back to life, meaning you were given the proper understanding. And people play and twist verses in the Quran to think that They're not going to be raised back to life again. As if there's no physical resurrection. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in Surah Al-Hud, in this verse, He's making it clear. If you said to them, indeed you will be resurrected. Indeed you will be brought back to life. After death. And Allah added in this verse, in a way that He didn't add in the other verses, مِن بَعْدِ الْمَوْتِ. After your death. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made it very clear in this verse that this resurrection that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is talking about, this coming back to life, is after your death. After your death. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala here is showing us that after we die, we're going to be raised up again. And that the people who disbelieve, they are the ones who disbelieve in this resurrection after death. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in Surah Al-Inshiqaq, verses 10 to 15, makes the whole issue of this resurrection after our death very clear, as he says, subhanahu wa ta'ala, وَأَمَّا مَنْ أُوْتِيَ كِتَابَهُ وَرَاءَ ظَهْرِهِ فَسَوْفَ يَدْعُو ثُبُورًا وَيَصْلَى سَعِيرًا إِنَّهُ كَانَ فِي أَهْلِهِ مَسْرُورًا إِنَّهُ ظَنَّ أَنْ لَنْ يَحُورَ بَلَا إِنَّ رَبَّهُ كَانَ بِهِ بَصِيرًا. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, as for the one who is given his book behind his back, then indeed he will call thubura. Maybe someone can, let me use the translation, I forgot the meaning of that word. And then he will enter into the hellfire. Indeed he used to be happy with his family. Indeed he used to believe that he wasn't going to be resurrected again. Certainly he will be. Indeed your Lord is basir over what he used to do. Allah is basir, Allah sees what he used to do. Here Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is making it very clear, and I wanted to mention these other verses in connection with this issue of resurrection so that we can have a fuller picture of what's going to take place. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is telling us here in Surah Al-Inshiqaq, as for the one who has given his book from behind his back, the book of his deeds, the book that has everything that we do in this earth in that book. And we mentioned many times that maybe the people who have come before us couldn't imagine one book with all of their deeds written in it. But today with this microfilm and microfiche and the computer chip, we can imagine a book in the palm of our hands that has every single thing we believed in, every single thing we said, and every single thing we did in our lives written down in one little book. We can hold it in our hands. This is what man could do. How easy is it for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to give us that book of all of our deeds? And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is reminding us of the losers here, those who will be giving their books behind their backs. Then they will, فَسَوْفَ يَدْعُو ثُبُورًا, as Mursal Khan translates, he will invoke his destruction. He will be called to his destruction. Jazakallah khair. And then he will enter the blazing fire. Indeed, he used to be happy with his family. Here Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is making the picture of the disbeliever very clear. Very clear. When he was living, he was just happy. Cooling out in his big house, fine car, nice clothing, sinning, living in fornication and adultery, cursing, hanging out, every sin you could imagine. Better get yours now, because after this it ain't no more. You only live once. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is showing here, he used to be happy with his family. When he was in this world, he was just happy. Yeah, getting high, living large. That's how the disbeliever used to be when he was on this world, when he was in this world. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is reminding us of what's going to take place after that death. That some people will be given the book of their deeds behind their back, in their left hand. And then they will be called to this destruction. And then they would enter the blazing fire. Only before, when they were living with their families, were they happy. Because on that day, when they die in disbelief, there's going to be no happiness. Indeed, they used to think that they weren't going to be resurrected. And the person who doesn't believe that he's going to be resurrected, you see him living his life recklessly. Disbelief, disobedient, following his own desires, because he doesn't think he's going to be accountable. He doesn't think that he's going to be held accountable. When someone knows that he's going to be held accountable for what he does, he watches what he does. And this is the life of the believer. That we know that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is going to hold us accountable for what we do. So we try to make sure what we do is in accordance with obedience to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and His Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sahbihi wa sallam. As far as the disbeliever, he doesn't think he's going to be accountable, so he does what he likes. He watches the law of the land because he knows that they're going to hold him accountable for what he does here. But whatever the law lets him go on, he thinks he's cool. Because cigarettes and alcohol and usury has been made permissible by the disbelieving government, he thinks that it's okay. I can go do it, ain't no problem. I bought in the cigarettes in the store, bought my riba, the bank hooked me up. He thinks that this disobedience is okay because the law of the land won't hold them accountable. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is going to hold them accountable. And we know that Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala is going to hold us accountable. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to give us an easy reckoning. Indeed, he will be resurrected. Indeed, his Lord is basir over what he used to do. His Lord sees what he used to do. And here Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is reminding us of his beautiful names and his lofty characteristics to show us that don't think that you can do what you want to because Allah sees you. And we know this as we backbite the Muslims day and night because the Muslims can't hear what we say. Don't we know that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sees? If we think that we can say something because the brother won't hear us, do we think that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala won't hear us? That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala won't see what we're doing? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sees and He hears what we do, and He's going to hold us accountable for what we do when He resurrects us back to life, and we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to save us. And this is the explanation of the statement of the Shaykh. And Allah will definitely resurrect those who are in the graves. And Allah has rose high above His throne, as He has said, Ar-Rahmanu ala al-Arsh istawa, from Surah Taha, verse number 5. Ar-Rahman has rose high above His throne. Here the Shaykh Abu al-Hasan al-Ashari, rahimahullah, is beginning to explain the belief of the Muslims in relationship to the characteristics of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That we believe in that which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has mentioned about Himself in His book. And we believe about Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala what His Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has mentioned about Him and those hadith that have been authentically reported on Him sallallahu alayhi wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam, as the Shaykh is trying to establish, Ar-Rahman wa ala al-Arsh istawa, Ar-Rahman rose high above His throne. Believe it or not, unfortunately some of the Muslims, they disbelieve in the fact that Allah has rose high above His throne, though Allah said it in the Quran. And here the Shaykh is establishing that he believes, as he says, and Allah has rose high above His throne. The Shaykh states this as a part of his belief, and then he brings the ayah. as we see that the Sheikh, when he was mentioning his aqidah from the beginning, that he was just basically mentioning things in brief without bringing their proof. And he said, later we will try to bring the proof for these things. But here on this point of establishing the characteristics of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the Sheikh, he doesn't wait, but he brings the evidences immediately to show us, don't disbelieve like those Muslims who have gone astray. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has informed us about what He has done. As He says, Ar-Rahmanu ala al-arshi istawa, Ar-Rahman was high above the throne. Let's not say, is it befitting for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to rise high above the throne? But we say that He rose high above His throne in a manner that is befitting to His majesty. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has done what He said He has. And He is who He say He is. And all of it is in a manner befitting to His majesty. Not to deny it in order to praise Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, as the people say, that we deny Allah's rising above the throne because we want to praise Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and to remove Allah from every defect. Rising high above something is a characteristic of a human being or animal, as they say. And that it isn't befitting to describe Allah in this manner. We're asking them, it isn't befitting to describe Allah in this manner? Who described Allah in this manner? Illallah. Other than Allah. Allah is the one who described Himself in this manner, and we describe Allah in the manner that He has described Himself, because Allah does not describe Himself except in a manner that is befitting to His majesty. If someone else be made a statement to describe Allah, then we would ask, is that befitting to Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, and to deny it from that person because that person made it up himself? But when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala feels a fit to describe Himself in a manner, whether we could understand the reason why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala describes Himself or in this manner or not, that we believe that which is in the book of Allah, and we say that it is in a manner befitting to His majesty. So the Shaykh rahimahullah Abu al-Hasan al-Ash'ari is establishing for us our belief in some of the characteristics of Allah tabarak wa ta'ala that other Muslims disbelieve in, though they are mentioned in the book of Allah. I'm saying that they disbelieve in these characteristics of Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, and not that they disbelieve in Allah, because those Muslims, and we're going to get to that point inshallah ta'ala, that those Muslims are mistaken when they disbelieved in these characteristics of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and that they didn't intentionally want to disbelieve in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They ran from attributing to Allah that which is not befitting to His majesty. They ran from that, and they fell into denying that which Allah has described about Himself. So they were running from one thing and ran into the next. And we only have to run from describing Allah in a manner that is not befitting to His majesty when it comes from other than the speech of Allah in the Quran, or from other than the tongue of His messenger sallallahu alayhi wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam. Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, in many verses in the Quran, He mentions that he has rose high above His throne. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us in Surah Al-A'raf, verse number 54, إِنَّ رَبَّكُمُ الَّذِي خَلَقَ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضَ فِي سِتَّةِ أَيَّامٍ ثُمَّ اسْتَوَى عَلَى الْأَرْشِ. Indeed, your Lord is Allah, the one who created the heavens and the earth in 6 days. And then He istawa عَلَى الْأَرْشِ. And then He rose high above His throne. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala here is describing Himself in more than one verse, as we saw from Surah Al-Taha, verse number 5. And now here in Surah Al-A'raf, verse number 54, that Allah rose high above the throne. And just as He tells us in Surah Yunus, verse number 3, إِنَّ رَبَّكُمُ اللَّهُ الَّذِي خَلَقَ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضَ فِي سِتَّةِ أَيَّامٍ ثُمَّ اسْتَوَى عَلَى الْأَرْشِ يُدَبِّرُ الْأَمْرِ. And this verse is similar to the verse before it. Indeed, your Lord is Allah, the one who created the heavens and the earth in 6 days, and then rose high above his throne, and he controls the affairs. He controls the affairs of the earth, that nothing takes place except from the control of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So here Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is basically mentioning the same verse twice. And we mentioned before that the Qur'an is a small book, and Allah was being very brief, and that if Allah tabarak wa ta'ala chose to mention something more than once in his brief book, his speech, the Qur'an, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is, as the ulama explained, that Allah is trying to show the importance of that thing. The importance of that thing, and here Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is showing the importance of believing that Allah rose high above his throne, as he tells us in Surah Al-Ra'd, verse number 2, Allahu alladhi rafa'a as-samawati bighayri 'amadin tarawnaha thumma istawa'a 'ala al-'arsh. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala here in Surah Al-Ra'd, verse number 2, tells us Allah is the one who rose, who has بغير عمد ترونها. Allah is the one who has lifted up the heavens, the skies, without any pillars that you can see, and he rose high above the throne. Here Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is mentioning another one of his characteristics, that he has the heavens lifted up one after the other without any pillars holding them up. And we couldn't imagine, and here Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is showing his greatness before he shows the greatness that he has risen high above the throne. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is showing us that he raised the heavens one upon the other without any pillars that you can see them, without anything holding them up. Can you imagine someone building a building with floors one after the other, nothing holding each floor up? But this is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala al-aziz al-qadir, the mighty, the powerful, the one who is able to do whatever he likes. And whatever Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants to do, he says, kun fayakun. Be, and it is. This is the power and the might of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, who has raised the heavens above us without any pillars that you can see. And then he rose high above his throne. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in these verses, and then there's many verses in the Qur'an where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala establishes for himself the fact that he rose high above the throne, as our Shaykh Abu al-Hasan al-Ashari rahimahullah is saying, and Allah has rose high above his throne, and he has, as he has said, Ar-Rahmanu alal arshi istawa, Surah Al-Taha, verse number 5. And then he goes on to say, and he, subhanahu, has a face without describing how, as he has said, wa yabqa, subhanallah, wa yabqa wajhu rabbika dhul jalali wal ikram. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in Surah Ar-Rahman, verse number 27. But before we get to that point, we wanted to mention this issue of Allah being above his throne, and the incident that happened with Imam Malik, Imam Dalul Hijra, rahimahullah, who died 179 Hijra, who they attribute the Madhab al-Maliki to him, and he had refused during his lifetime that anyone would make a Madhab out of his works. Imam Malik rahimahullah was teaching the believers in the Prophet's masjid sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Imam Malik had a man come into the masjid and question him, Ya Abu Abdullah, and this was the kunya of Imam Malik, Abu Abdullah. Ya Abu Abdullah, we've read in the Quran, Ar-Rahmanu ala al-arsh istawa. Ar-Rahman rose high above his throne. How did he rise high above his throne? Imam Malik rahimahullah, he couldn't believe his ears. They said he bent down and he picked up a stick. The floor of the masjid of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam was dirt. Nowadays Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has blessed us with this beautiful carpet, alhamdulillah. الحمد لله حمدا كثيرا طيبا مباركا فيه. Because we don't know how many of us would be Muslims if this masjid was a dirt floor. We don't know how many of us would be Muslims if this masjid was a dirt floor. So alhamdulillah. And we should praise Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala every time we get a chance to take off our shoes and walk on this carpet. Because this is one of the bounties of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And we need to praise Allah and to thank Allah for the bounties that He has provided us with, has bestowed upon us, that the people before us didn't have and were more thankful than we are. Imam Malik rahimahullah, he picked up the stick and he's just rubbing it in the ground, winding it like this out of his anger. And they say he's turning red, rahimahullah, out of his anger. And then after a while, he finally looks up and he tells him, the istiwa, or the fact that Allah rose high above His throne, is well known. Belief in it is wajib, compulsory, obligatory. The question about it is bid'ah. The question, how did Allah do what He did, is a bid'ah. And I don't view you as being other than someone is astray. And then he commanded the people to kick him out of the masjid, and they threw him out of the masjid. And this story is mentioned in many of the books, as I'm narrating the story, and it comes from different narrations from the book Aqidatu Salaf Ashabul Hadith, the Aqidah of the Salaf, the people of Hadith, from Imam As-Sabuni Rahimahullah. And he narrates this story by the chain back to Imam Malik rahimahullah, and this is an authentic story back to Imam Malik inshallah ta'ala. But we saw that Imam Malik rahimahullah, he taught the believers that which is proper. This istiwa is well known, meaning the meaning of istiwa means to rise high above, that the meaning is well known. The how, and I forgot to mention this part, the how Allah did something is unknown. It's unknown because only that which is known about Allah is that which Allah has mentioned in His book, or that which the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam mentioned. Allah didn't mention how He rose high above the throne, but He mentioned He rose high above the throne. So the fact that He rose high above the throne is well known. How is unknown because Allah didn't mention it, nor did His Messenger sallallahu alaihi wa alihi wasallam mention it. So it's unknown. Belief in it is compulsory. Because belief in everything, every letter of the Quran is compulsory. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Alif Lam Mim. What does that mean? No one knows what it means. Alif Lam Mim. These are letters that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has revealed in the beginning of some of His surahs. And in those surahs, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions, in many of them, that you can't even bring a surah like it. You can't bring a chapter like it. And Allah just mentions three letters. Bring something like that. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has the believers to believe in His book in all of it, every single letter of it. And a part of it is Ar-Rahman wa 'alal arshi istawa. So the belief in it is compulsory because it's a verse in the Quran. The question about it is bid'ah. If the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, if he didn't understand something, he could ask Jibreel alayhi salam. And if the companions of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam didn't understand something, they would ask the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. If the tabi'un, the companions of the companions of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, didn't understand something, they would have asked. You tell me generations went all the way up until the time of the Imam Malik. And he was born 96 Hijra and died 179 Hijra. You tell me up to that time no one questioned except this man walking into the masjid, that his question is a bid'ah. And that no one would make this type of questioning except someone who was deviant. And for that, Imam Malik threw him out of the masjid. As one of the characteristics of Imam Malik was that he was as hard as anybody could be on the deviant Muslims. That Imam Malik was extremely harsh on the deviant Muslims. Threw him out of the masjid for a question. You can imagine nowadays if the one teaching the class, he heard a question from somebody and just threw him out the masjid. Everybody will say the brother is crazy. Give the brother a lesson to teach the people, and then astaghfirullah. And then he wants to be the prophet. Does whatever he wants to do to the people. But we saw that Imam Malik rahimahullah, his stances against the deviant Muslims were harsh, and that the people, every time his name is mentioned, Imam Malik rahimahullah. And that this is the status of Imam Malik. And to show a bigger status of Imam Malik, and this is how hard he was. But to know his status, everyone knows if we mention Muhammad ibn Ismail al-Bukhari. If someone says, who is al-Bukhari? Everybody knows the level of knowledge of Imam al-Bukhari, because he has this book that is considered the most authentic book after the book of Allah, the Quran. And that's his Sahih al-Bukhari. Imam al-Bukhari said the most authentic chain back to the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is the chain of Imam Malik on the authority of his uncle Nafi', on the authority of Abdullah ibn Umar, on the authority of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam. And when you read Sahih al-Bukhari in the Arabic, you see that often Imam al-Bukhari, he quotes the chain of Imam Malik back to the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. That those hadith that you have in the Muwatta of Imam Malik, you see them that they're in also in Sahih al-Bukhari, because Imam al-Bukhari, he knew the place of Imam Malik in this deen, and this is how harsh he was on the deviant Muslims. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to give us the courage to take a stance like the people who came before us against those deviant Muslims when they deviate from the Salatul Mustaqim. And this is why the deen was so strong in those days and so weak in these days. Because when deviants stepped on the scene by means of a question, they just took care of it right away. And now we let all kind of deviants crop up and do whatever it wants to. And we just say, oh, let them do whatever they want to. How in the world are you going to let deviant Muslims do whatever they want to? Lead the innocent people astray? You're just going to let the deviants lead the innocent Muslims astray and say, that's okay? Don't talk about them, akhi. Wallahi, the people who came before us, they set the example for us that when deviant steps on the scene, just to knock it out right from the beginning. And that if the people don't understand this, and if that the people don't like this, and if the Muslims don't have the backbone to stand on this truth like the people who came before us, then that's their problem. But alhamdulillah, we're reading the Aqidah of Abu al-Hasan al-Ash'ari, and we're learning about, inshallah, and the face of your Lord, Dhul Jalali wal Ikram, remains. فَبِأَيِّ آلَاءِ رَبِّكُمَا تُكَذِّبَانِ. So which of the bounties of your Lord will you deny? Here Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when He says, وَيَبَقَى وَجُهُ رَبِّكَ ذُو الْجَلَالِ وَالْإِكْرَامِ, and the face of your Lord will remain. Here Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is talking about when everything is destroyed on this earth, the face of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would remain. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in this verse is describing Himself as having a face. And we describe Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala by that which He has described Himself as. We say that Allah has a face because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has described Himself as having a face. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to bless us with looking at His face on Yawm al-Qiyamah. As this is one of the virtues or the blessings of being rewarded with Jannah, is to look at the face of Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, as Allah describes in Surah Al-Qiyamah, وُجُوهٌ يَوْمَ إِذٍ نَاظِرَةٌ إِلَىٰ رَبِّهَا نَاظِرَةٌ. On a day where faces will be brightened, looking at their Lord. And the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam had explained from the verse of Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, لِلَّذِينَ أَحْسَنُوا الْحُسْنَى وَزِيَادَةٌ, for those people who do good, they will have al-husna wa ziyada. And the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam gave tafsir to this ayah by saying al-husna is jannah and al-ziyada is looking at the face of their Lord. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will reward the people who do good in this world. Those people who have belief in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and proper belief. Those who are obedient to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and His Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Those people who do good in this world, they will have al-husna wa ziyada in the hereafter. They will have al-husna, or as the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam explained, al-jannah. Wa ziyada, the look at the kareem face of their Lord. The noble face of their Lord subhanahu wa ta'ala. So we believe that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has a face. And we go back, as the ulama of Islam, they go back to the principle or the rule that was set by Imam Malik. A face is well known. The how is unknown. Belief in it is compulsory, and the question how is a bid'ah. This is to go for all of the characteristics of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. When Allah describes Himself with a particular characteristic, that characteristic is well known, we say it's well known. How is Allah's face? It's unknown. And that question, how is Allah's face? Is it like ours? It has two eyes, a nose, two lips. That question is a bid'ah. And the believer shouldn't even tolerate that question, but belief that Allah has a face as He has described Himself by is compulsory on the believers. And as we're saying, and here we see from this example, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala only commands us to believe in that which is good for us. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has only detailed for us an aqidah, a belief system that is beautiful, that is correct, that is right. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has chosen us, the believers, the Muslims, and made us the best ummah. And we have the best aqidah, walhamdulillah. And our belief that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has a face, that when we believe that Allah has a face as He has described Himself as, not only do we benefit in believing in that which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has described Himself as, but we desire to look at the face of our Lord on Yawm al-Qiyamah. And we know that the people who are going to look at the face of their Lord, Tabarak wa ta'ala, on Yawm al-Qiyamah, are the people who do good in this world. And every time we remind ourselves of our belief that Allah has a face, it should increase us in good deeds. It should increase us in good deeds so we can be among the people who will look at the face of Allah Tabarak wa ta'ala on Yawm al-Qiyamah. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to bless us with a look at His face on Yawm al-Qiyamah. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to save us from being among the people who have knowledge that doesn't benefit them. To believe that Allah has a face and then continue to do bad deeds. What good is your belief if you still are continuing to do bad deeds? It's as if you don't even really believe in it. And this has been, as we heard it in the past, this is why people have pointed the finger at some of the people who said, we are the Salafis. They say, yeah, we hear you emphasizing this aqidah or this belief, but we don't see anything in your actions. We don't see any deeds. All we see you is mimicking, we believe that Allah has a face. We don't know how His face is. It is in a manner befitting to His Majesty. And that whoever disbelieves in this, disbelieves in that which is in the Quran, and we're going to call him a kafir, or whatever the people used to say. As the people who believe, inshaAllah ta'ala, in the Book of Allah, the Quran, and the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, with the understanding and the practical application of this Quran and Sunnah, the way that the Salaf practiced it and understood it, the Prophet and his companions, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam wa radiyallahu anhum, and the tabi'un and the tabi' tabi'un rahimuhumullahu ajma'in, and everyone who followed after them who understood and practiced this Quran and Sunnah in the same manner, that us inshallah understanding and practicing this Quran and Sunnah the way that the people came before us understood it and practiced it, let us not have the people point the finger at us saying those are the people who inshallah have the correct belief but no deeds to go along with their belief. So we should let these lessons, inshallah ta'ala, be reminders to us and warnings to us from allowing our deeds to go down the drain. or allowing our character not to be a good type of character that is befitting of the Muslim. So when we remind ourselves of our belief in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we're always saying that these beliefs should encourage us to do good deeds. Just as we see from this issue of belief in the face of Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, that the only people going to see Him are the people who do good in this world. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in Surah Al-Baqarah, verse number 115, says, وَلِلَّهِ الْمَشْرِقُ وَالْمَغْرِبِ فَأَيْنَمَا تُوَلُّوا فَثَمَّ وَجُهُ اللَّهِ إِنَّ اللَّهَ وَاسِعٌ عَلِيمٌ. And Allah owns the east and the west. And wherever you turn, then there is the face of Allah. Indeed, Allah is wasi'un alim, or indeed Allah is the wide, the all-encompassing, the alim, the all-knower. So here Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He describes Himself as having a face. And here Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in this verse in particular, is just showing that though Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had His Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to command the believers to face a particular direction when they make their salah, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has commanded us to face the Kaaba when we make our salah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reminds us, though you have to face this direction when you make the salah, that no matter whatever else you do, wherever you are, or whatever direction you face, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is there holding you accountable for what you do. So it could have crept into the minds of some people that if you face the Qibla, the Kaaba, when you make your salah, because Allah is going to hold the people accountable who face that direction. As if you were in some other direction, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wouldn't hold you accountable for the things you did when you were outside of your salah, or if you were facing the other directions. But that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would hold you accountable for what you did and whatever direction you did that thing you did in. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows best. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us in Surah Ar-Rum, verse number 38, ذَلِكَ خَيْرٌ لِلَّذِينَ يُرِيدُونَ وَجَهَ اللَّهِ وَأُولَٰئِكَ هُمُ الْمُفْلِحُونَ. And this is the latter part of the verse where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, this is for those who desire the face of their Lord, or the face of Allah, and those, they are the successful. Here Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is showing us that those people who are desiring to look at Allah tabarak wa ta'ala's face, or Yawm al-Qiyamah, they are the successful people. And we have mentioned, as we saw from the tafsir of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, those who will look at Allah's tabarak wa ta'ala's face on Yawm al-Qiyamah are the people who do good in this world. And those people who are doing good, desiring to see the face of Allah, they are the successful. The people who are working hard at trying to do that which will guarantee them a look at the face of Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, they are the successful. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us among the successful. So here Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in these verses, and there are other verses in the Quran where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala describes Himself as having a face. And we say, as our Shaykh Abu al-Hasan Al-Ashari rahimahullah says, and He subhanahu has a face without describing how, as He has said, وَيَبَقَى وَجُهُ رَبِّكَ ذُو الْجَلَالِ وَالْإِكْرَامِ, and the face of your Lord will remain forever, ذُو الْجَلَالِ وَالْإِكْرَامِ. And this is one of the beautiful names of Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, meaning full of majesty, bounty and honor. The Shaykh, rahimahullah, he goes on and says, and He, subhanahu, has two hands without describing how, as He, subhanahu wa ta'ala, has said in Surah Al-Sad, verse number 75, وَقَالَ يَا إِبْلِيسُ مَا مَنَعَكَ أَن تَسْجُدَ لِمَا خَلَقْتُ بِيَدَيْ أَسْتَكْبَرْتَ أَمْ كُنْتَ مِنَ الْعَالِينَ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, oh, and then the Shaykh goes on and said, and as He has said, subhanahu wa ta'ala, بَلْ يَدَاهُ مَبْسُوطَتَان, in Surah Al-Ma'idah, verse number 64. Here Allah tabarak wa ta'ala tells us, in verse number 75 of Surah Al-Sad, He said, O Iblis, What prevents you from prostrating to the one I created with my two hands? And this is Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala speaking. Are you arrogant? Are you arrogant or are you among the Most High? Are you arrogant or are you among the Most High? Here Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He tells us that He has created, and He's referring to Adam sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, with His two hands, tabaraka wa ta'ala. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is telling us in this verse in Surah Tusad, verse number 75, that He has created Adam with His two hands, and that He has commanded Iblis, la'anahu Allah, may the curse of Allah be on him, to prostrate to Adam. And he didn't. And he was cursed because of it. But Allah tabarak wa ta'ala had mentioned here that He created Adam with His two hands. And for this, the Shaykh is saying, and He subhanahu, glorified is He, has two hands without describing how. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says He has two hands without describing how. And Allah tabarak wa ta'ala in His book has mentioned that He has two hands. Just as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us in Surah Al-Ma'idah, verse number 64, His two hands are outstretched, and He gives to whoever He wills. So here Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala also in Surah Al-Ma'idah, He says that He has two hands, and that they're outstretched, and that He gives to whoever He pleases. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in His book has described Himself as having two hands. And the Shaykh Abu al-Hasan al-Ashari, rahimahullah, he's describing Allah without describing how. He's describing Allah as having two hands because Allah has described Himself as having two hands. And here, this is a point also that the deviant Muslims, they disbelieve in, as they think that having hands aren't befitting to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Having hands aren't befitting to the majesty of Allah tabarak wa ta'ala. But those people who believe in the truth of the book of the Quran and that which has come from our Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, we believe in that which Allah has described Himself by. If Allah has described as He has in His book that He has two hands, then we describe Allah as having two hands in a manner that is befitting to His Majesty. Because everything is related to Allah tabarak wa ta'ala is in a manner that is befitting to His Majesty. And we don't deny anything with the claim that it's not befitting to His Majesty, except that it hasn't come from Allah Himself or from His Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam. And we see, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us in Surah Al-Ali Imran, verse number 26, the benefit of believing that Allah tabarak wa ta'ala has two hands, as Allah tells us, قُلِ اللَّهُمَّ مَالِكَ الْمُلْكِ تُؤْتِي الْمُلْكَ مَنْ تَشَاءُ وَتَنْزِعُ الْمُلْكَ مِمَّنْ تَشَاءُ وَتُعِزُّ مَنْ تَشَاءُ وَتُذِلُّ مَنْ تَشَاءُ بِيَدِكَ الْخَيْرُ إِنَّكَ عَلَى كُلِّ شَيْءٍ قَدِيرٌ. Allah tabarak wa ta'ala says, I command you to say, O Allah, مَالِكَ الْمُلْكِ, the King of Kings, you give the kingdom to whoever you please. And you take the kingdom away from whoever you please. And you make mighty whoever you please. And you humiliate whoever you please. In your hands is all good. Indeed, you are Qadir over all things. Indeed, you have the ability to do all things. You have the power over all things.
Here Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is showing us that all good are in the hands of Allah tabarak wa ta'ala. And why don't you believe in that which Allah has described Himself as all of the good are in the hands of Allah tabarak wa ta'ala. It's as if you don't want any good. No, I don't believe Allah has hands. Allah, when He says His two hands are outstretched, He means His blessings goes far and wide. And some of the people translate and interpret Allah's statement, بَلْ يَدَاهُ مَبْسُوطَتَانِ, rather His two hands are outstretched. They translate it to say His blessings and His favors go far and wide. All of the good are in the hand of Allah. How are you going to deny that which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has attributed to Himself, especially when He said the good is in it? And Allah tabarak wa ta'ala mentioned that after He said He gives the kingdom to whoever He pleases. And He takes it away from whoever He pleases, and He gives might to whoever He pleases, and He humiliates whoever He pleases. Do you think that Allah tabarak wa ta'ala is going to give the kingdom to the people who disbelieve in that which Allah has described Himself as? Do you think that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is going to make mighty those who disbelieve and that which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has described Himself as? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has described Himself as having a hand, as He does in Surah Al-Mulk, the first verse, تَبَارَكَ الَّذِي بِيَدِهِ الْمُلْكِ وَهُوَ عَلَىٰ كُلِّ شَيْءٍ قَدِيرٍ. Blessed be the one who in His hand is the dominion, the kingdom, the sovereignty. And He is Qadir over all things, and He has power over all things. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He describes Himself as having a hand in these verses. And those other verses, He describes Himself as having two hands. And we describe Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in a manner that He has described Himself in, and He has only described Himself in a manner that is befitting to His Majesty. Can you imagine Allah describing Himself in other than a manner that is befitting to His Majesty? And He, subhanahu, has two hands without describing how, as He, the Glorified, has said, that which I have created with my two hands. And He has said, rather His two hands are wide open or spread out. And He has an eye without describing how, as He subhanahu said, تَجْرِي بِأَعْيُنِنَا, from Surah Al-Qamar, verse number 14, and she floats under our eyes. And here Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is referring to the fulk of Nuh, or the Noah's Ark, and that it was floating on the water under the eyes of Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had described Himself in His book. And just as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has described Himself in Surah Al-Tur, verse number 48, that He has eyes, as He says, وَصْبِرْ لِحُكْمِ رَبِّكَ فَإِنَّكَ بِأَعْيُنِنَا وَصَبِّحْ بِحَمْدِ رَبِّكَ حِينَ تَقُومُ. And be patient with the command of your Lord. Whatever Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala has commanded the believers to believe in, to say and to do, be patient in obeying the commandments of Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala. Indeed, you are underneath our eyes. Or indeed, you are in the sight of our eyes. And praise and glorify the praises of your Lord when you wake up. So here Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in these verses also describe that He has eyes, tabaraka wa ta'ala, and that we are in the eyes, or we are in the sight of the eyes of Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala, and that Allah is looking at us and watching us what we do, as He is al-basir, the seer. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has described Himself in these verses and in other verses that He has eyes. And we describe Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala by that which He has described Himself as. And we don't deny any of that. It was on the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to proclaim this messenger. And it's upon us to submit to it, to believe in it and to submit to it. It was upon the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam to proclaim this message, and it's upon us to believe in it and to submit to it. And then the Shaykh, rahimahullah, he goes on and says, and whoever thinks that Allah's names are describing other than Him, then he is astray. Whoever thinks that Allah's names are describing other than him, then he is astray. And we would deal with that next week, inshallah ta'ala, as this was the explanation of the statement of the Shaykh. And Allah will definitely resurrect those who are in the graves. And Allah has rose high above his throne, as he said, Ar-Rahman rose high above his throne, Suratul Taha, verse number 5. And he, subhanahu, has a face without describing how, as he has said, and the face of your Lord will remain forever, full of majesty, bounty and honor, Dhul Jalali wal Ikram, Surah Ar-Rahman, verse number 27. And he, subhanahu, the glorified is he, has two hands without describing how, as he has said, that which I have created with my two hands, referring to Adam, Surah Al-Sa'd, verse number 75. And as he has said, rather his two hands are wide, are open, or are spread out, Surah Al-Ma'idah, verse number 65. And he has an eye. And the Shaykh, rahimahullah, he mentioned here in the singular that Allah has an eye, but we saw from the text of the Quran that Allah tabarak wa ta'ala had mentioned in the plural, bi'ayunina, in view of our eyes, without describing how glorified is he, as he says, when she floats under our eyes, or the Noah's Ark is in the view of our eyes, the eyes of Allah tabarak wa ta'ala. And whoever thinks that Allah's names are describing other than him, then he is astray. And we'll continue with that next week. This is what we wanted to offer this week. Wa sallallahu wa sallam wa baraka ala nabiyyina Muhammad wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam. Wa subhanaka allahumma wa bihamdika ashhadu an la ilaha illa anta astaghfiruka wa atubu ilayk. Walhamdulillah. The brothers in Asbury Park, if there are any questions that you had on today's lesson, inshallah, you can take the time to ask them now. And for the future classes, whoever has a question, at the point that he has a question, he can stop the dars so that we can entertain his question at the time that he feels something isn't clarified, and no one has to feel that he has to wait to the end of the class in order to phrase the question. So if there are any questions now, or during the class, if there are any questions, you can stop me at any point and then to phrase your question.